In the previous section, we saw how we could use, you know, buses like the APB and AHB to deal with, you know, faster interfaces such as Ethernet. But we saw that there was a problem maybe with the CPU. So remember, we asked if AHB was fast enough, and we saw that the AHB throughput was 6.4 gigabits per second, which should be sufficient for the Ethernet and even for dealing with a few Ethernet ports, even though not that many. But we have to ask if the CPU can deal with that. And let's see. So the Ethernet rate was 2 gigabits per second. And we have a CPU, you know, a small CPU that has a 32-bit word. It takes us, at the minimum, the bare minimum, three instructions to store and load a word. So something like we could do a load word type of a operation, then we'd increment the address that we're looking for, and then we'll loop back. So that's a minimum, bare minimum of three instructions per a load or a store operation. So therefore, we're getting actually, you know, only like 11 bits per instruction. Okay, and with a 100 megahertz CPU, we see that we get a whopping, you know, 1.1 gigabit per second, which is smaller than our Ethernet rate, and the CPU really can't handle that type of a thing to do that. So the CPU, again, is too slow, and what can we do? So back to our kind of the place that we are here. We have the CPU. Now it has its Ethernet port over here, and the Ethernet is over AHB transferring all this data, but the CPU is too slow to handle it. So what can we do? Well, we can offload the CPU again, and that we will do with a block that we call a DMA, or direct memory access. So what is a DMA? A DMA, a direct memory access, is a bus operation that allows reads and writes that are not controlled by the CPU. So you see we have the processor over here, and the processor has to read from memory and write to an accelerator, then the accelerator does its job, and then read from the accelerator and write to memory. So it has to do some sort of an operation where it needs to transfer data to the accelerator to work on. Okay, so a DMA transfer is controlled by what we call a DMA controller. So that's going to be some sort of an accelerator that we have that requests control of the bus from the CPU. So the DMA controller now is going to be a master on the bus. And with control, what happens, the DMA can go and do these read and writes directly between the device and the memory. So it can transfer stuff to the accelerator and take it back, transfer stuff from that Ethernet port to a memory to memory on the chip, and move things from memory to the Ethernet port, and it doesn't have to have the processor dealing with it. DMA needs a few more signals. So if up till now we were kind of assuming that our CPU is the only master of the bus, now we added another master of the bus, and so we have to have some sort of a simple arbitration. Since it's the only master that we added, we just can add a direct request and grant between the DMA controller and the CPU, and the CPU can decide to grant access to the DMA controller to go and actually go and move things from the device to the memory and from the memory to the device without going through the CPU. So the DMA has a bunch of registers. It has a starting address register, a length register, a status register. Using the status register, the CPU can start and install the DMA. So basically, the DMA, all it does is kind of a stupid type of thing that all it can do, it gets an permission from the CPU to take control over the bus. It gets instructions that tell it, listen, take this chunk of memory, move it over to there. Take this chunk of memory, move it over to there. And then it can do that. Once it completes its operation, it interrupts the CPU to tell it the transfer is done. But in the meantime, the CPU can do whatever it wants. The DMA usually works in short bursts, something like 4 to 16 words, and therefore it will only occupy the bus for a small amount of time, and the rest of the time the CPU can use it to continue its other operations. The DMA, of course, can be more adapted to do this type of transfer. So if our bus was 32 bits, but our AHB was a 64-bit AHB, we can have our DMA be 64 bits to be able to, you know, deal with faster access. So let's see, once we've added our DMA, which is going to do something like this, okay, it's going to take, you know, stuff from the Ethernet and transfer it over to DMA, then the DMA is going to go over and write it to memory. And so again, it's going to do that. The problem with that, of course, is that it doubles kind of the amount of time that we take up our bus, because we're reading from the port to the DMA, then the DMA is taking what it read and writing it back to memory. So of course, if it's something like Ethernet, which is really going to be a high-speed interface that's going to be dealing with a lot of data, what we can do is we can implement the DMA as part of the Ethernet, and then we don't have to go through the bus and then to memory. the bits can go over here to the DMA, and the DMA can directly transfer to memory to, again, save our, you know, the bandwidth of the bus over here. So we see that this can be done, but what about the CPU? Because the DMA now can really take care of this, you know, 6.5 gigabit per second of the AHB. Maybe it can do even more if we want to have several Ethernet ports and so forth. But can it do everything? And the question is, what about the CPU again? Can the CPU do anything with that data? I mean, we just made this whole, you know, type of system, and we don't even care about the CPU, or do we? Does the CPU have to actually do anything? And let's remember, we have our, you know, Ethernet packet. It's this whole big thing. And the data is here in the middle of it. But actually, in our router, all we're doing by the CPU is deciding where, you know, the packet came from and where we should transfer it to next. So that is actually all in this information over here in the preamble that tells us the source address, the destination address, and the type. And therefore, that's really all we need to process. We don't really need to process the entire big, long package. And that brings us back to the math board again. And so let's look at these two types of terms, data rate and packet rate. So when we discussed the bit rate, we said that the Ethernet is at 2 gigabits per second. And we know that each packet includes something like 20 bytes of overhead on it. So the data rate is actually the bit rate times, you know, the size of the data divided by the size of the data plus the overhead. Okay, and so if we have a 64-byte packet, it comes out something like 1.5 gigabits per second. That's the data rate. But if we have a larger packet, like a 1.5K byte payload inside, then we're going to have something like 2 gigabits per second. So larger packets mean that the internet connect is busier. But is that what we care about? Or do we actually care about how many packets there are? Because the CPU actually only has to look at each packet, take the preamble there of the packet, and deal with that. So its decision rate is a bit different. What is the packet rate? How many packets per second do we get? That we take the bit rate and we divide it by the entire size of the of what we're receiving over there, and times 8, because the bit rate is in bits and this was in bytes. Okay, so when we take a payload that's only 64 bytes long, what we get here is about 3 million packets a second. 3 million packets a second is quite a lot, but if we take a much bigger payload, you know, we have these 1.5 K byte payloads, what's going to happen is that we only have, you know, something like 1.5 kilo packets a second. So a much fewer packets per second. So smaller packets mean that the CPU has to do more. Whereas if we have bigger packets, we have fewer packets per second. And then the CPU actually has to do a lot less processing because the packets are bigger. It doesn't actually have to look at these 1500 bytes. It only has to look, you know, at this 20 byte preamble or something like that to decide what to do. So what we want is to have larger packets. But unfortunately, you know, the Ethernet, it supports this whole spectrum of packet sizes. So we're going to have to go for the worst case and see if we can deal with that. Let's see if the CPU can deal with it. Okay, it needs to handle the packet, which means it needs to figure out where to send the packets to. So it really doesn't care about the data rate. The data rate was taken care of by our DMA. It has to care about the packet rate. So it has to go take, you know, the relevant data from each packet, decide what to do with the packet. How much work can the CPU do on each packet? So there's a whole bunch of instructions. You know, there's a whole program that has to go and take that preamble, decide what to do with it, and give the next instruction of where to send the packet to. Maybe build a new packet and send it on to the Ethernet port. So if we have a packet with 1.5 kilobyte of data, the packet rate is about 160 kilopackets per second. At 100 megahertz, that gives us 615 instructions per packet. 615 instructions in assembly is really not that much, but it's still a substantial number of instructions. So let's say maybe the CPU can handle it. But if we go down to the minimum, you know, 64-byte packets, it means we only are left with 34 instructions to deal with each packet. And there is no chance that we're going to be able to do everything that the router needs to do with only 34 instructions. And that means that the CPU, again, has failed at its job. And so what can we do? And the trivial solution would be to raise the frequency of the CPU. So instead of using, you know, a 100 megahertz CPU, we could use a gigahertz CPU. You know, we get a 10x speed up or something. But raising the frequency has its limitations, of course. That's still not enough. We could add additional CPUs. So we could have several CPUs, and each one would work on a different packet. And again, we get an additional advantage over here for the CPU. But really, the best solution would be to integrate dedicated hardware. So we want to use accelerators, which we briefly discussed, and what we call application-specific processors. Okay. So if we look at a typical router SoC, and this is kind of wrapping up everything that we have on our router, we will have some, you know, hardware accelerators. So these guys, the parser, classifier, policer, traffic management, these are like hard-coded kind of blocks that they do a very specific operation. They do it really well at high throughput, at high energy efficiency. They're hard-coded. That's all they can do. The problem is they can't change. And, you know, all kinds of standards change, things change. We don't want to go and throw away our chip minute something changed. So we want some level of programmability. And that's why we add these ASIPs, these application specific instruction processors. They are some sort of a programmable accelerator. So the accelerator can do several things well. It may not be a Turing machine that can do everything that a CPU can do, but it can do many things well, but it has some level of programmability. We can write some program to change how exactly it handles each of the packets or something like that. So we will use these ASIPs to do some of the job. It will still do it much better than CPU because it's really designed only to deal with the type of processes that it should deal with, but we leave some level of programmability to let it handle changes in standards, different workloads, different types of use cases that it has to deal with. And of course, we're going to have some sort of a main CPU, you know, a big ARM core or something like that, that's going to be the host. It's going to be able to run, you know, our user interface where we actually interact with the router, and all kinds of other general things that has a full, you know, Turing machine that we can program it to do everything. But the host really is bored most of the time, sitting around there just making sure that everything's working okay, where the rest of the guys are all crunching all of the bits, so we can support all of these mini Ethernet ports that are all trying to move data at a very high speed across our router.